Christe. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save, till on that cross as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid, here in the death of Christ I live. There in the ground his body lay, light of the world by darkness lay.
Good morning, and thank you for joining us. We're genuinely excited that you've chosen to spend this time with us as we come together to worship God and delve into the teachings of his word. For those of you who are joining us for the first time, we're excited that you're able to worship with us. You can explore more about Jesus, our church, and ways to connect with Harvest by going to our website at harvestbaptist.info. Before we begin, I want to encourage you not to be a passive observer, but an active participant in our service. Sing along with us, engage in our prayers, and follow closely as we dive into a thought-provoking passage from the Scriptures. Our service will begin shortly, so take this moment to remove any distractions and prepare your heart.
Good morning, church. If you're glad to be in God's house, can I get a big hearty amen? All right, let's stand together and let's sing of God's mercy. His mercy is more. Praise the Lord, his mercy is more.
Sins, they are many, his mercy. us. His blood was the payment, his life was the cost. We stood neath a debt we could never afford. Our sins, they are many, his mercy.
You know, in life, there's not too many things that are guaranteed. Sure, most products come with a 30-day money-back guarantee, but how many of you have tried to get your money back and been denied because of some random clause in the fine print? Well, in spirituality, the Bible, the gospel, and even God himself makes us a guarantee that if we believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, we will be saved. No prerequisites, no strings attached. Jesus paid our sin in full, and he confirmed the new covenant in his blood when he rose from the dead. You know, it's a comforting and a joy-producing truth that the God who controls everything assures us of our salvation. This morning, it's our prayer that you would be reminded of the joy of your salvation and that you would praise God for his love. Let's sing Blessed Assurance.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God. Born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my submission, perfect delight. Visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending, bring from above. Echoes of mercy, whispers of love.
Sing it out this morning.
This is my story, and this is my song.
My soul. pray with me this morning? Heavenly Father, today we recognize your holiness and your power. We revere and we respect you, understanding that you alone are totally in control of everything. In your church and in our lives, let your will be done. We submit to you and we lay down any control that we think we might have. This week, would you give us what we need to accomplish the good works that you've prepared for us, and give us the courage to take action? God, please forgive us for falling short of your standard. And when someone wrongs us, let us remember to forgive them as you faithfully forgive us. We want to live holy lives, reflecting your love and mercy to everyone we encounter. In times of temptation, would you be near to us? Through your Spirit, help us to avoid sin and to pursue righteousness. Each day, help us to crucify our flesh and allow Christ to have dominion in our lives. You get all the honor, all the glory and praise, and we look forward to the day when every knee shall bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. And it's in the precious name of Jesus that we pray. Amen. Yet not I, but through Christ in me.
What gift of grace is Jesus, my Redeemer? There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus, for my life is wholly bound to Him. Oh, how strange and divine, I can sing, all is mine, yet not I, but through Christ in me. The night is dark, but I am not forsaken, for by my side the Savior, He will stay. I labor on in weakness and rejoicing, for in my need His power is displayed. Jesus bled and suffered for my pardon, and He was raised to overthrow the grave. To this I hold, my sin has been defeated, and Jesus now and ever is my plea. Oh, the change.
Some great singing this morning. You may be seated.
Prince of glory died. Heavenly harmonics and the praise they bring. Amen? How about that? Amen. Well, if you are visiting today, thank you so much for coming out. I got to meet a few visitors already, and I told them that, we love having visitors here. My name is Justin DeFons Blakesley. I am part of our visiting team. Some of you are laughing, but, I've been coming here for about 18 years, and it's been nothing but happy days. Hey. All right, yeah. Dad jokes aside, we're glad you're here. And I told those visitors, and I want to tell any other visitors, stop out in the lobby. If we didn't get a chance to meet you already, we got a gift box for you. We want to put that in your hands. Our only ask is that you would look in front of you. There's a card that looks like this. If you fill that in, turn it after the service. Now here, in a moment, when we get up to shake hands, special favor. You guys do a great job of welcoming people, but please, today especially, because of these two visitors, Matt Freeman and I talked to them for about 10 minutes, and we're probably the two last guys Pastor Mark wants talking to visitors, because you've learned to love us. We're a little bit different, but we love Jesus. So they need to meet some more normal people. So let's stand up, greet those around you.
While our in-service friends are shaking hands, I wanted to take this time to talk to you. I hope you're having an amazing time worshiping with us so far today. As we are currently enhancing and furthering our reach with the gospel, I want to ask if you would be willing to come alongside us by contributing to our ministry at harvestbaptist.info/give. Your generous gift will not only go towards our in-person ministry, but our online ministry that you're taking part of right now. And to our existing contributors, we extend our heartfelt gratitude. If you live in Allegheny, Westmoreland, Armstrong, or Butler counties and are currently without a church community, I want to invite you to worship with us in person on Sundays at either 9 a.m. or 10:45 a.m. Our campus is located at 224 Harvest Lane in Natrona Heights, Pennsylvania, and are equipped with nursery services for infants and toddlers, special programs for children and teens, and small groups for everyone else. Feel free to bring your entire family and join us for an enriching worship experience. It's almost time for our announcements about the latest events and updates at Harvest. Following that, we'll look at a passage of Scripture that will help us gain deeper insights into God, the Bible, and how we can live a fulfilling life through our relationship with Jesus.
We're going to sing together one more time the chorus of His Mercy Is More. Let's sing together. Praise the Lord, His mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, anew every morn. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more.
Great singing today. You may be seated.
Well, some of you picked up, I don't always wear a suit, but he spoke of guarantees. I bought this from Men's Warehouse because they said, you're going to like the way you look. I guarantee it. I tried to take it back because I said, look, my biceps still look small, and they pulled out the fine print. That's what they do. All right, well, hey, if you're back, we're glad you're here. Last week was a great service, but you know, my favorite service is always the one we're in. And I love the way we ended it, talking about the apostles. They got that fire in them. And I hope you're on fire, but if you're not, we got three opportunities on campus to help stoke the flames, all right? First of all, if you're newer to the church, maybe you've been coming for a while, you want to get more plugged in, even if it's your first time, immediately after this service, in our cafeteria, we have our Intro to Harvest class. This is a great class to learn more about who we are as a church, talk to some of our leadership, get questions answered. Many of you might have kids with you. That's okay. We've got childcare provided. We've got snacks to tide you over till you get to lunch. So I hope you will partake in that and see us again immediately after the service in the cafeteria. Next in line, we got a Dominican Missions Interest Meeting. All right, that's happening in room 400. Which is the exact opposite part of this campus in that corner. This I can't tell you about it because I'd steal Brother Aaron's thunder. You want to go there. You want to find out more. The only bad thing about this trip is you'll be Googling Bible verses on patience because it's not till 2025. But some of you like to plan. Some of you that don't, we'll tell you about it later. But today you need to get to that interest meeting so you can learn more about it. All right, another opportunity tonight. Many of you have signed up for the Growth Track series that starts tonight. That's at 6:10. Some of you, I can see it, you're like, I forgot. We'll make it work, all right? We'll make it work. That's what we do. So show up 6:10, room 400 again, that far corner. That begins tonight. Now, this last announcement I'm most excited about, all right? I'm going to tell you the what, then I'll tell you the why, all right? Volunteer Appreciation, Sunday, April 21st, starts at 6 o'clock. Now look, we know life's busy. We've got childcare provided. We've got the meal provided. I heard taco bar, right? I'm excited about that. All right, so here's the thing. We know that many of you are already planning to come, but please get signed up. That'll help us plan for that, okay? Statistics have shown if you offer a $50 gift card in a raffle, one of you's gonna get it, all right, by April 14th, get signed up, and that might be yours, which is just gravy with that taco bar and childcare, am I right? All right, now why are we doing this? This is to thank all of the wonderful visitors we have, all right? Especially those that work with our children, all right? We love the fact that there's so many volunteers here. We want to thank you above and beyond. This is our chance, and I know this event means something to this church. They all do, but I know Pastor Mark was telling me he's involved with it. It's going to be a night of fun, a night of fellowship. They're going to be laughing. I don't know what that was. We'll just let that slide. Stuff's flying out. Maybe that's me. But anyway, yeah, just cut that from the tape for the online people. All right? But no, fellowship, fun. All right? There's going to be training to get you more equipped. So we hope you'll get signed up for that again. That is April 21st, but by the 14th, please register online. At this time, if you notice your program, one chapter wonders. You've got my interest peak. I had to wait through the first service. Now I'm ready to hear what it's all about.
We'll be there in a minute, and we will say a more thorough appreciation to you on the 21st if you're one of the 400 or so people that volunteer here on a regular basis. But let me just say a big thank you right now to everyone who played a part in our Easter weekend. From childcare to greeting to setting up food to the music team, and so many of you made our Easter weekend happen. Just a tremendous thank you. It was such a joy and a blessing to be a part of. We were rehearsing some of the numbers in staff meeting this week, and our Good Friday service grew by about 20% year over year. Was the biggest one we'd ever had. Our Easter Sunday grew by about 10% year over year, and we actually set what I think may be the all-time attendance record for our church. We had almost 1,300 people here last Sunday. It was 1,284 was the exact number. And a half dozen people told us just very overtly and plainly, like, hey, I'm putting my faith in Jesus today. I'm crossing the line of faith today. I'm believing on him. Another half dozen kind of let us know that, but also it was a little bit maybe unclear. I have some more questions, and we're following up with them. But just a joy to be with God's people, to celebrate, to worship. Worship together, to laugh and to smile together, but then even to see people put their faith in Jesus. It's what it's all about. It's what it's all about. So thank you for being a part. And if you were on the receiving end of anything, you were greeted, you were sung to, they watched your kids, would you like say thank you to everyone else who served you and made Easter weekend happen? truly, team effort, huge team effort, and thank you so much for it. We got a lot of texts and emails and just feedback from the weekend, which was overwhelmingly positive and just a great time. But there was one text that stood out. We were having Easter lunch. We got done here and wrapped up and got over to the house, and I think there were 30 or so people at our house for a big Easter lunch. And shortly after lunch, this text came through, which was my favorite communication on Easter weekend all weekend long, which was this picture. And the text said, "The chicken is good, but the sermon was even better. Happy Easter." And I just want to thank, you know who you are. You sent that to me. I've never been so thoroughly roasted and complimented at the same time. And I felt very insecure and confident all at once, which is hard to do. So thank you for that. But seriously, we got a lot of amazing feedback, including that one. And it did make me laugh immediately. And I've always wanted to be a part of a church where it wasn't full of a bunch of curmudgeons who are just too serious and can't have a good time and can't laugh. So I enjoy having a good time and laughing, even if it's at my own expense at times. But it's always a lot of fun. Well, it did remind me, though, just seeing Colonel Sanders, of this church that I used to drive by. This is not related to my sermon at all. I just felt like sharing it. I used to drive by every day on the way to school when I was in high school. They had this marquee sign out on like this major road that everyone saw, and they would change the message every week, you know? And it would always try to be clever and witty, those sorts of things. But I still remember one. I don't know what they said any other week, but I remember one sign that they had out, and it said, "How would you like to spend eternity, original or extra crispy?" That's what their sign said. And so that's actually the title of my message today. No, I'm just kidding. We're not talking about that today. We are actually in the book of Obadiah today. So if you have a physical copy of God's word, you're not looking on your phone or an iPad, but you have like a Bible bound in leather on your lap, wave it at me if you got a Bible, okay? Who has a Bible? Okay, most of you do here. All right, go to the table of contents. Okay, let's start there. Most of these have a table of contents. And towards the end of the Old Testament section, you'll find Obadiah. Mine is page 915. It may help you find it. It is this, what we're calling a one-chapter wonder. It's one chapter. It's 21 verses. It's very brief. Nestled in the Old Testament. Its neighbor is Jonah. You've likely heard a sermon on Jonah. You likely have not heard a sermon on Obadiah, partially because it's a little tough to untangle at times, and partially because it's just so brief. So out of curiosity, has anyone heard a sermon on Obadiah that you can remember? Raise of hands. Anyone can remember? Okay, we got maybe five or six. So for the majority of you, this will be very new. It's very brief. It is the shortest book in the Old Testament. And we'll make quick work of it. We'll get through it in just two or three weeks, and you'll know a whole book of the Bible in just a couple weeks. But Jerome, the early church father, said that Obadiah was as difficult as it is short. He said, this book is hard to understand, and it's become now to me known as the crab legs book of the Bible. Crab legs are something that are extremely hard to get to the meat. It's a lot of work to break them open, and you don't even get a lot of meat out of them, but the meat's really good when you get it. Crab legs are actually, my wife and I, we have two dates that we love and we put on repeat relatively often. One is brunch. That's our number one. We love brunch. If you know a great brunch place, let us know, because we've tried a lot of them around the city. The top of our list would be Pamela's is number two. They're the runner-up. Nice, thin, crispy pancakes. They're delicious. But top of our list actually is The Lot in Oakmont. I don't know if you've ever had brunch there, but they have a great brunch. They're not a sponsor of today, but whatever. You can go there. But crab legs is another one. We don't eat crab legs often. We don't have the budget for it, really. But when we do, we always enjoy it because we have to stop, slow down. You don't have a fork in your mouth constantly. It requires work, and it's just kind of a long, meandering experience, and we get to talk a lot. And Obadiah is that way. It's a lot of work. You really just get a little bit of meat, but the meat that you get, it is delicious. It is unbelievable. It is so good. And today we're going to get just a piece of it. So we're going to cover nine verses today and try to get the backdrop of Obadiah and start to learn at least one of the major themes of the book. And we're going to talk about the power and the peril of pride. So if you would, look at verse number one. Obadiah. It says, the vision of Obadiah. So if you're like, why do we call it Obadiah? That's why. This is a prophecy that is coming via God through Obadiah. We really don't know much about this guy. We know his name's Obadiah, the end. Obadiah was a pretty popular name. There's 13 different Obadiahs mentioned in the Old Testament, and we aren't really sure who this guy is, who his dad was, where exactly he lived. We just don't know. Obadiah is actually a semi-popular name today. I was walking down the hallway, and Kelly caught me. She said, Obadiah today. I knew what she was saying because they have Obadiah as part of their family. My sister-in-law, or soon-to-be sister-in-law, my younger brother gets married next month on May the 10th. And my soon-to-be sister-in-law says that if she has a baby boy, eventually, that she wants to name him Obadiah and call him Obi for short. And I suggested Obi-Wan Kenobi instead and call him Obi for short, but they didn't like the suggestion. So now the only thing that's come out of it is now I always think of Obadiah as Obi, and then I think of him as Obi-Wan Kenobi every time I read the book now. But Obadiah, it's the guy who wrote the book. And he tells you up front what the book's going to be about. Here it is. Thus saith the Lord God concerning Edom. So this is a prophecy, specifically a prophecy of judgment against Edom. Now, who or what is Edom? That's a really important question to understand what the book's about. Edom is a neighboring nation of Judah, or you could even say of the Israelites. This is a map of ancient of Israel and Jordan and that area surrounding the Jordan River and the Dead Sea. This would be stereotypical of what things would have looked like in roughly 700 to 900 BC, kind of that time frame. You would have had, at a certain point in time after Solomon, the country of Israel splits into two, a northern kingdom and a southern kingdom. That's illustrated on this map. In blue is the northern kingdom called Israel. The southern kingdom is kind of in a pinkish purple called Judah. But if you look below Judah, which is where Jerusalem is, you would find in yellow Edom. South and even east of the Dead Sea is the nation of Edom. If you put that area on a modern map, it would look like this. It would be southwest Jordan would end up being where Edom is predominantly located. But Edom is a country. It is a place that is right next to Israel. Now, Edom is more than a country, though. In the Bible, you have Israel, which is a nation, but Israel, the nation, comes from one particular Bible character who had a different name than Israel, but was renamed Israel. Class, you tell me, who was the Bible character that was renamed Israel? What was his name? Jacob. There's also a Bible character who had a given name, but was renamed Edom. Now, who was the one who was renamed Edom? Esau. Now, why is that significant? Because Jacob and Esau are not only brothers, they are twin brothers. So to really get the backdrop for this book, you have to go all the way back to the tent of Rebekah and Isaac, where Rebekah is now pregnant with paternal twins. And Genesis 25 tells us that in the womb, these dudes were kicking and screaming. These dudes were mad at each other prenatal and fighting with each other. And Rebekah is like, what are they doing inside of me? Like, they are scratching and clawing each other in there. And then they are born. Esau is born first. He gets the name Esau, and then Edom literally means red because he's born very hairy and red hair, which would have been very not normal. So he's born with red hair. The Edomites end up going to this particular region that's known for its red rock, which also kind of indicates perhaps why the name is Edom or red. But Esau's first, Jacob is second, and then the story starts to unfold. Jacob tricks to a degree Esau into selling him his birthright. Esau is famished and says he's gonna die and ends up selling his birthright for a cup of soup. Later on, Jacob definitely deceives his father. His father, Isaac, can't see well anymore. So Jacob puts a bunch of hair on like he's hairy and pretends and poses like he's Esau and convinces his father to give him the blessing. And it's at this moment that Esau becomes infuriated. These guys were water and oil to start with. But it's after this where Jacob deceives his way into the blessing that Esau decides he's not only angry, but he has murderous intentions. And Jacob runs for his life. He finds himself with Laban, he gets married, and eventually he comes back, but he is extremely skittish when he comes back because he's convinced that Esau still wants to kill him and he doesn't know what is going to happen, but God has done a work in Esau's heart and Esau actually now is not only forgiving, but he is willing to give Jacob the birthright. Jacob comes back, Esau surrenders the land to him and decides to move to Mount Seir, which is where Edom was on that map. And then the story goes cold. You don't hear a lot about Jacob and Esau. All right, he went his own way. You know, the story of forgiveness, great. And then Israel moves to Egypt. They become slaves in Egypt. And many, many years later, they leave Egypt in the Exodus. And then you pick the story back up because as the Israelites come out of Egypt into the promised land, they eventually have to pass through Edom. That is the most direct route. And they come to the Edomites and they say, hey, let us go through your land. We won't look at anything. We won't touch anything. We won't do anything. I promise you, we will be very civil. We will go through peacefully. Let us go through. And they say, no. Come on our turf. And we're going to come out and we're going to make war with you and we're going to fight tooth and nail to the death. No, please let us go through. I promise we'll be peaceful. No, take the long way. And this hostility is revisited. And all of a sudden the nations are no longer, they really weren't friends to begin with, but there's definitely a hostility. The story continues to unfold for many, many years. And what you find is that there are altercations and skirmishes for centuries. For a long time, these neighboring nations fight with each other. I put a bunch of references in your notes. You can go through this week maybe in your own time, and you can read these different accounts from Deuteronomy and Judges and Samuel and Chronicles and Kings and Psalms about all these skirmishes that these two nations had together. Two that are notable would be Hadad, an Edomite king, who plagued King Solomon. David was able to, in his rule and reign, to basically eliminate the entire Edomite kingdom, but there was one who escaped, Hadad. He was a young boy. He went to Egypt, and he grows up there, but then David dies. Solomon takes over. Solomon begins to commit polygamy, and he's an offense in God's sight, and God raises up Hadad and brings him back, and there's this resurgence of the Edomite kingdom, and Edom plagues Solomon with King Hadad. The one that is most of note, though, that you need to know is fast forward to slightly after 600 BC. So you're talking centuries after centuries. You finally get to where Judah, southern Israel, is going to be conquered by Babylon. This is something that nations have been unable to do. Jerusalem was almost this impregnable fortress up on the hill. And Babylon eventually is able to not only besiege them, but they're able to conquer. But what you find in the story is that they have some help and assistance. They specifically have the help and the assistance in an alliance that they made with the Edomites. And the Edomites don't just stand back at a distance and say, yay, we're glad that Israel got conquered. We've been fighting with you for a long time. They join in and they even provoke Babylon to be more insidious than they would have been. And they try to egg Babylon on to burn more than they need to, or plunder more than they need to, or kill more than they need to. And then Edom begins to pick off the Israelite refugees and take advantage of Israel at a very, very weak moment. And it is that particular moment that has caught God's attention, that we'll see next week, is going to be the genesis of this particular prophecy. That God says, I'm not okay with this, and I have a prophecy against you. And here is the prophecy as it starts. Back to it, verse number 1. We have heard a rumor from the Lord, an ambassador is sent among the heathen. So God's telling us that he's stirring up the heathen nations. What is happening? What is he saying to them? Arise ye, let us rise up against her in battle. So God is going to stir the hearts of pagan kings. He's not going to use the Israelites to do this. He's going to stir the hearts of pagan kings to come against you and to fight you in battle. Verse number 2, behold, I, God, have made thee small among the heathen. Thou art greatly despised, which was already kind of true. Politically and economically, Edom was not a very successful place, really. You had to get through there on some trade routes, but it really wasn't a powerhouse. Edom is always like the tag-along. They're always the third wheel. They're always on the bench. They'll join in the fight, but they're never the main player, really. I've made you small, verse number 3. Listen to it. The pride of thine heart, it has deceived you. Thou that dwellest in the cluster of the rock, whose habitation is high. And you say in your heart, what? Who shall bring me down to the ground? And they did literally dwell in the clefts of the rock. Now this is being used metaphorically to describe the haughtiness of their heart, but they were in these very mountainous regions and they were tough to pin down. I don't know, has anyone ever been to Petra? Maybe you've been to the Middle East. Anyone taken a journey to Petra before? Petra is in where ancient Edom would have been. And there's a bit of debate as to if Petra was actually created by the Edomites or it was created a few years later after they're wiped out. But this is what you're talking about, these red rocks. If you've ever seen Indiana Jones and seen the, you know, when he goes there, that it's hard to fight when someone's up on this rock. How am I going to get up there? Those sorts of things. You dwell high. You think you can't be brought low. I'm going to bring you low. Verse number 4, though thou exalt thyself as the eagle, and though thou set thy nest among the stars, thence I will bring thee down, saith the Lord. Now, what is this initially? At its core, this is a lesson on not only the power, but the peril of pride. And you see that pride does at least 4 distinct things in this text. First, you see that it defies God. The whole prophecy is God tipped, God in wrath, God mad. Why is he so mad at the Edomites? Well, there's a couple reasons, but it all starts with pride. Because pride is thumbing your nose at God. Proverbs 6 tells us that there are 6 things that God hates. And the top of his list, number 1, forgive me for that popping. I don't know what's happening with this mic, but we'll get it figured out. Number 1 on God's hate list is pride. These 6 things doth the Lord hate, yea, 7 are abomination to him, a proud look as number 1. Peter would tell us that God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. He resists the proud. He lines himself up in battle against those that are proud. Now, to be clear, when we're talking about pride, we're not talking about, hey, basketball team, you did a great effort out there. I'm proud of your effort today. That's not what we're talking about. We're not even talking about, I'm proud to be an American. We're not even talking about a good self-image, so to speak. The Bible, and the gospel specifically, is the most nuanced that you could ever find when it comes to our self-image. It allows us to have an extremely confident yet humble self-image. Only a Christian can say, you know what? I am confident that I am a child of God. I am secure in Jesus. I am literally a saint. I have this extreme confidence. I am loved by the creator of the universe, but at the same time, be very humble. I am not loved because of my good works. I am loved in spite of my good works. And it is the grace of God that has done this. I am a sinner saved by grace and a saint all at the same time. There's no other religion and there's no other philosophy that does this. It allows you to have a very humble self-image, but at the same time, a very confident self-image. We're not talking about a confident self-image. We're talking about pride, and at its core, pride is this idea that you can be independent from a creator God. That you can live life and do life and even be successful without his help. That you don't need him. There were 2 guys that were not only arrested, but they were sentenced to jail for their role in the Watergate scandal with President Nixon. One of them was Chuck Colson, Nixon's hatchet man. the guy who at one point in time not only suggested that they give steel pipes to people to go beat up protesters because they didn't like what they were protesting, but also suggested that they bomb the Brookings Institute in D.C. in an effort to cover up Watergate. When you have someone who suggests we just bomb a building, like, that's not a good person. He eventually found his way to jail, and in jail he found Mere Christianity by C.S. Lewis, this book that he read. And he put his faith in Jesus and converted to Christianity. And then Chuck Colson became one of the best apologists and really tools in the hands of God to influence and reach lost people for God. But one of his co-conspirators, the lawyer who had his hand in the Watergate scandal, was George Gordon Liddy. Gordon Liddy was also sentenced to prison for conspiracy and burglary and illegal wiretapping. And Liddy is most famous for saying that he had tremendous faith. But this was his faith. I quote him, "I have found within myself all I need and all I ever shall need. I am a man of great faith, but my faith is in George Gordon Liddy. I have never failed me." That's Gordon Liddy. That's pride. My faith is in me. I can get the job done. Now, it's easy for us to say, oh man, George Gordon Liddy, what a guy. I mean, he's very prideful. But time out. That same idea plagues many of us and many Christians. That you can do it and you're fine. I may need God for salvation, but you know, I got the rest. It's under wraps. This is one of the primary reasons that oftentimes we are very prayerless. Because we think we got it. If you thought you needed God, you would pray a little bit more. How many of you, out of curiosity, raise of hands, have a job? You have a part-time or a full-time job currently. You are employed? Raise of hands. All right, keep your hand up if you also have a car. All right, I didn't see many hands go down. All right, you put your hands down now. If your car broke down tomorrow, what would you do? You would fix it. You would rearrange your schedule. You would get it to the shop. You would figure it out. You would find the money. You would put it on a credit card. You would do whatever you needed to do to fix your car, because the vast majority of you would say, I need a car to get to work, and I need work for money, and I need money to pay my bills and live. So you interpret your car, and I won't disagree with you, as a necessity. I need this. So if something goes wrong, you will inconvenience yourself, you will figure it out, you will prioritize fixing your car. Yet at the same time, we will not inconvenience ourselves for prayer, nor will we prioritize prayer. And the reason that we won't inconvenience ourselves or prioritize it is because fundamentally we don't think we need it. We think we'll be all right that day or that week or that month without spending much time and saying, Lord, give me today my daily bread. I'm fine. The pantry's full, the garage is full, the attic is full, the cupboard is full, I'm fine. Now, what is that? That is the exact same thing as George Gordon Liddy. It is pride and a faith in yourself. Pride is something that defies God and says, I don't really need you. James 5 says the same thing, and I won't take you there or spend much time on the topic, but James 5 says, those that will go to and from and buy and sell and make travel plans and do all this stuff, but will not say, if the Lord wills, will not include God in their plans, those are the people who are guilty of evil boastings, and that boasting is evil. Those are the people that are so prideful that you think you can plan your whole life or your whole week or your whole year, and you can do it without God and not consult him or depend on him. And what is that? It's evil boasting, he says. It's prideful. So pride defied God, and God got mad at it. God got real mad at it and said, I'm going to whack you upside your head. I'm done with this. I am sick of this. It defies God, but it also deceives you. You may have missed it, but verse 3, when we're introduced to the idea of pride, it tells us, the pride of thine heart hath what? Deceived thee. Your pride has deceived you. This is the trickiest part of pride. Absolutely the trickiest. You oftentimes don't know that you are smitten by it. Other sins have a silver lining. And this is not to talk fondly of sin at all. But when you're an adulterer, you know it. When you're an addict, you know you're an addict. When you're a thief, you know you stole stuff. But when you are guilty of pride, more often than not, you're oblivious. You're deceived. You don't think that it's an issue. This is why, honestly, I don't enjoy preaching on pride. Number one, it's very convicting. But number two, almost nobody wants to hear the sermon for themselves. Everybody wants to say, great sermon. I'm going to send it to my boss. He's super prideful. My spouse, I hope that they were listening. My kids, I mean, they're so egotistical, it's unbelievable. I'm going to let them listen to this sermon. But nobody wants to look in the mirror and think that they themselves are guilty of pride. So while we talk this morning, can you do yourself a favor and do me a favor? Can you ignore all of them and just stop and look at yourself and say, is this in me? And is there a blind spot? Am I being deceived by it? And I can't really see it. You say, well, how would I know if it's there? I put a list of questions at the end of the outline today, and you can go through and ask yourself those questions as a bit of an acid test to figure out if it applies to you or not. But ask yourself, am I prayerless? Ask yourself, do I look down my nose at other people often and think, you know what, you should work harder. You should get your act together. You should grow up. If you're looking down your nose, you're prideful. C.S. Lewis famously said that you cannot be prideful and have a good relationship with God at the same time. Because if you're prideful, you look down on other people. And if you're looking down on other people, you cannot look up to God. You got to pick one. You're looking down or you're looking up. Pride eats away at us and it deceives us more often than not. 1 Timothy chapter number 3, Timothy is given instruction by the Apostle Paul. And Paul tells Timothy that I want you to go find some guys that are cut from the right cloth, who are not newbies and novices, and I want you to appoint them as pastors and elders. But he tells Timothy that he should not pick a novice for one key reason. I'll quote him. He should not be a novice, lest being lifted up with pride, he fall into the condemnation of the devil. What was Paul saying? I think he was saying very overtly that there is a unique pitfall to pastors, and there's a unique pitfall even to those that are in leadership, that they would be guilty of a tremendous amount of pride, and that will be the condemnation of the devil. Pride is what made the devil the devil. The son of the morning became Lucifer when he was exalted with pride and exalted himself against God. And what he's saying is, this is, it's tough, and they're going to have to learn to circumnavigate this, and you can't just put a novice in there or they will be eaten up with pride. And as a pastor, I can attest to this. Most of my life, the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes would have been predominantly what I wrestled with in terms of sin categories. Like literally the day I became a pastor, the pride of life became something that I wrestled with far more than the other two. It's not to say that I never wrestled with the other two, but the pride of life became so pronounced, and it still is so easy to be eaten up with. Well, what do they think? Do they approve? Do I appear prepared? Will they co-sign on this? Are people happy? And you can be so enamored with pride, and that's why it's good sometimes where you have friends that call you Colonel Sanders and roast you, because it helps humble you a little bit, you know? Pride can get you, it's deceptive. Always has been, always will be. It defies God, it deceives you, but then it divides relationships. One of the questions you can ask yourself is, how healthy are your relationships? If you are plagued by unhealthy relationships, there is a strong, strong, strong chance that pride is at play in a major way in your life. Here's what verse number 5 says of Obadiah. If thieves came to thee and robbers by night, then there's this parenthetical with an exclamation point. How art thou cut off? Edomites, you're toast. I'm telling you, rest in peace. You're done. If a thief and a robber came by night, would they not have stolen till they had enough? And he's saying what we know. If someone's going to rob you at night, they don't pull up a U-Haul and take your whole house. They normally don't steal your couch. They steal the valuables. They get maybe the expensive electronics or those sorts of, they don't take everything. Then he says another rhetorical question. If grape gatherers came to thee, would they not leave some grapes? It was customary in that day when you gathered grapes to leave some on the vine or on the floor for those that were poor. You didn't take all of it. And we'll see as the text goes on that what he's going to describe is that when you are plundered, when you have the enemies come against you, they will not relent. Their appetite will be insatiable. They will take everything. They will leave nothing. You are done, done. Verse number 6. How were the things of Esau searched out? How were his hidden things sought up? So this is talking about what was common in that day, that you would literally bury treasure. You would take your goods and your valuables, you would lock them in a very secure temple, or you would hide them in a cave, or you would bury them somewhere, and all of your hidden stuff is going to be brought up. All of this treasure that you think is secure, it's going to be found, and you're not going to have anything left. Verse number 7. I want you to underline three different phrases if you're in the habit of underlining in your Bible so that you can see how the friends are going to be divided, how pride will ruin these alliances and friendships. All the men of thy, and here's the word, confederacy, your alliances, the people that you're friends with and that you're partners with, they have brought thee even to the border. Meaning your military is going to have to go defend her borders because of your friends. They're going to turn against you. The men that were, and you can underline this, at peace with thee. The people that were at peace with you, they've deceived you. They've prevailed against you. You're going to be betrayed by your friends. If that wasn't clear enough, they that, and you can underline, eat thy bread. The people that you made a treaty with and invited over to your house to sit down at your table and have a meal with you or have a banquet with you, right? You don't invite your enemies over for dinner very often. Your friends that eat with you and dine with you, that are your good, not just acquaintances, but friendships and the people that you have alliances with, they have laid a wound under thee, or we would say they put a trap for you. They have laid a wound under you, and there is none understanding in him, in Edom. You're oblivious. Your friends have put a trap under you and you don't even know it. You are about to get stabbed in the back. What is it saying? It's saying what is always true of pride. Pride divides friendships. It's almost impossible for it not to. Because if you are a prideful person and you have a friend, that friend is either humble or prideful. If they are humble, they will see your pride more than likely and they'll be turned off by it and they'll probably leave. If they are prideful, which is more often the case than not, birds of a feather flock together, don't they? If you're prideful, you will attract other prideful people. And when you get a bunch of prideful people together, that is a recipe for disaster. You now have laid the foundation for betrayal and for people to stab you in the back and to work against you, and to justify it in their own eyes, and to feel good about it, and to somehow make excuses for it. What happened in that betrayal? Well, there was pride in that betrayal. Now listen, and listen carefully, because this is going to offend some of you, and it's going to be tough love, but you need it. This is not the case for every betrayal. Okay, so the asterisk that I'll put on the statement is that it's not the case for every betrayal. Because some of you know what it's like to be betrayed by your parents, by your spouse, by your children, by your best friend, by your boss, by whoever. That's not the case for everyone. But if there is a pattern of betrayal in your life, it's highly probable that the root issue is you and your pride. It could be that you as a prideful person are magnetizing other prideful people to you, and then they betray you. And then you cry the blues and say, why did it happen to me again? And the issue at its core actually may be you. Now, I'm not excusing their betrayal. I'm not saying that that's right or justified. But I am saying you can set yourself up for failure and for a world of hurt because of your pride. Pride is deep down in the root system of every war, of every divorce, of every fractured family. There's pride down there in the soil. What does Proverbs say? Only by pride cometh contention. It kills relationships. Why does the apology stick in your throat? Pride. Let me change that. Why does the apology stick in my throat? Pride. Why are we so defensive when someone gives us a criticism? And it ruins not just our day, it ruins our week. Emotionally, it ruins us because they said something negative about us, our work, our project, whatever we did. Because you're prideful. Because I'm prideful. Why can't a dad apologize to his kid? Your kid was in the wrong, sure, but you were too. And you lost your temper. And you misread the situation. Why can't you confess your sins and tell them that you're sorry? Pride. Why do you keep hiding that sin? The one that you want to confess and you want to get rid of and you want to bring to the light, but you can't bring yourself to do it. Why can't you? Because of your pride. Pride kills relationships. It hurts families. It hurts churches. You know why churches split? Because there's prideful people in them. And there's prideful pastors that pastor them. That's why churches split. This is a shot across the bow. And the script has already been written for Edom. It's done. It's not like, hey, repent and I'll take it back. It's done for them. Rest in peace. You're toast. But it is a warning for you because your marriage isn't done and your relationships aren't done and your friendships aren't done. Those aren't done. Pocket your pride. Breathe in some humility. Make some apologies. Own where you've been wrong. Don't be so defensive and help your relationships out. Don't be prideful. So what does pride do? It defies God, it deceives them, and then it divides the relationships, but then lastly, it destroys them. Not just their relationships, just them in general. Verse number 8. Shall I not say in that day, saith the Lord, even destroy the wise men out of Edom and the understanding out of Mount Esau? Look, you're going to be obliterated. Verse 9. Thy mighty men, O Teman. Now Teman is another name for Esau or Edom. Teman was one of the descendants of Esau, and it's kind of like a nickname for Edom. Thy mighty men shall be dismayed to the end that every one of the mount of Esau may be cut off by slaughter. What is it saying? You're done. The road to ruin is paved with pride. Your financial dealings, take whatever area of your life you want. Financially, some of you are ruined because of pride. Because your neighbors keep buying things that you can't afford. And your pride won't let you not buy them too. So you spend money that you don't have on things that you don't need to impress people you don't even like. And now you're financially ruined because your pride wouldn't let you not have that stuff. Emotionally, someone says one negative thing and it ruins you. Maritally, I've already said it. Pride ruins relationships. Pride goeth before destruction and a haughty spirit before a fall, does it not? Solomon wasn't lying when he wrote that. God resisteth the proud, but giveth grace to the humble. Pride destroys people spiritually. Hell is populated with a lot of prideful people who could never walk through the low door of humility and say, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. But instead, wanted to think that they could do it, or their own good works were good enough, or their baptism was good enough, or whatever it was that they did, but could never accept the plain, stone-cold truth that you don't save yourself and your goodness won't get it done. You need to rely on God. Now, it takes humility to do that. You have to be willing to swallow your pride to do that. But spiritually, if you will, if you will humble himself, because God doesn't just resist the proud, but what does he do? He gives grace to the humble, right? How are we saved? We are saved by grace. How do you get grace? You humble yourself. You confess your sin and you say, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. That's how you get grace. It's humility. And the irony of pride in churches and pride in Christians is that if there was ever a group of people that should know something about being humble in receiving gifts of grace, would it not be Christian people? Like, correct me if I'm wrong, but if my doctrine's straight, you can't be a Christian unless you first humble yourself to get the grace of God. And if that is how you begin your Christian journey, shouldn't you know something of how to continue that way? But oftentimes we begin our journey that way and we are humble, or the tears flow, or we confess our sins and we're very broken, and God saves us and redeems us, and then we become very prideful spiritually. That's not only ironic, that is disastrous and devastating. That Christians should be the people, most of all, that know what it's like to be confident that God has done something for me, but also be humble that he did for me what I could not do for myself. So here's the point, and I'll end. Spiritually speaking, there is not a single person in this room that is so bad that God won't save you. I'm going to give you a chance to put your faith in Jesus in just a minute, to pray and call out to him. But know before that that there's not one of you that's so prideful, so wrong, so sinful that Jesus won't save you. It doesn't exist. Not one of you is so bad that he won't, but not a one of you is so good that you don't need him to save you. And that's where we get hung up. We think, I'm good enough. I'm not that bad of a dad. I mean, come on, give me a break. I'm a good employee. You know, if I don't know, all the citizens were like me, I keep the laws good enough. I think our prisons would be less populated if people were like me, and it's your goodness that is the real hurdle. You're not too bad that he won't save you, but you're not too good that you don't need saving. I don't care who you are, how moral you are, how upright you are, how much you help people. I don't care. You have to be willing to humbly say, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. So if you know what that's like and you've done that before, then my word, may we live out of humility. May it characterize who we are as people. May it characterize who we are as a church. May it characterize your family. May your kids say in your obituary one day at your funeral, Dad was a humble man. He was confident in what God did for him. He was confident in his abilities, but he was humble. Mom was a humble mom. May we live out of that as Christians, but if we're not Christians, then may today we walk through the low door of humility and put our faith and our trust in Jesus. Would you pray with me? Father, we thank you for the opportunity to look at the initial snippet of this prophecy from Obadiah to Edom. May we learn an invaluable lesson that pride is ruinous. God, may we change our ways. May we humble ourselves. God, I'm reminded of your word that if my people will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, I will hear from heaven and heal their land. The dominoes start falling with humility, and may that domino fall in our heart this morning. Help us to be humble people. This morning, I want to give you just a minute to talk to the Lord. If you are a Christian, if you know Jesus, thank him for salvation. Remind yourself of how utterly dependent you are on him for salvation, for eternal life, for security. And then remind yourself of how dependent you are on him just to get out of bed tomorrow. That you need his grace to function, to work, to live. If pride is something that you know is an issue, then would you confess it, like lay it down, repent of it, call it what it is? If you're in the room and you don't know Jesus as your Savior, and you want him to save you, he will. I was talking with someone after the first service, and they were sharing their testimony of a lot of addiction, a lot of rehab, a lot of jail, but how God had redeemed them. I don't care who you are. God can redeem you. But you have to be willing to say, be merciful to me, a sinner. It takes humility. So would you make that your prayer today? If you don't know Jesus, cry out to him right now from your heart. It doesn't have to be out loud. It can be literally silently in your heart, and not to me, but to him, and say, Jesus, be merciful to me, a sinner. I am throwing myself on your mercy, and I'm saying, please forgive me. Cleanse me, redeem me. I need you to do it. The only way this is possible for you is because Jesus died for your sins and he rose from the dead. So tell him, Jesus, I'm believing on you. You say, Jesus, I believe you died for me and I believe you rose from the dead. My faith is only in you. It doesn't have to be those words, but if you'll pray something like that, he makes you a guarantee, as Matt said this morning, that whosoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Put your faith and your trust in him and him alone. Jesus, we think it's fitting this morning to end not only with a word of gratitude and praise to you, but a word of gratitude and praise that you, the one who is God become man, and you knew it. You didn't forget that you were God, but you chose to humble yourself and to become obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. The ultimate condescension and the ultimate humility we see manifested in you. And may we, as your followers, bear this image. May we be made to look more like you when it comes to our pride and humility. May we be marked by humility. And Jesus, we ask this in your precious name. Amen. I almost never end a service with a quote. I was in the sermon that way, and then I'll pray. But I'm going to dismiss you this morning with a quote. This is from Abraham Lincoln. It's the middle of the Civil War, and Lincoln declared a national day of fasting and prayer, which is not uncommon for presidents to do, but also a national day of humiliation. Now, that's not common. He said, we got to humble ourselves. And these are his words. Now, this was true in the Civil War. Have mercy, how true is it today of us and our society? But let's not be guilty of pointing the finger at the society and not looking at us. These are his words. And I think good advice for each of us this morning. We, as Americans, have been the recipients of the choicest bounties of heaven. We have been preserved these many years in peace and prosperity. We have grown in numbers and wealth and power as no other nation has ever grown. But we've forgotten God. We have forgotten the gracious hand which preserved us in peace and multiplied and enriched and strengthened us. We have vainly imagined in the deceitfulness of our hearts that all these blessings were produced by some superior wisdom or virtue of our own. Intoxicated with unbroken success, we have become too self-sufficient to feel the necessity of redeeming and preserving grace. Too proud to pray to the God who made us. May that not be true of us. Can I take Lincoln's cue and proclaim a national week, not a national week, a local harvest week of humiliation and prayer? I think it'd be good for us to say, God, thank you for what you've done in my life, but we understand it's not me, it's you. We sang it this morning, yet not I, but Christ in me, right? Let's have a week of humiliation together. Love you, church. You're dismissed.
Questions about having a relationship with God, please utilize the Contact Us button on the same webpage, harvestbaptist.info/gospel. To our regular viewers, thank you for your continued participation. It's our prayer that this message would encourage and equip you in your relationship with God. For additional information about our church, find ways to connect, please visit Harvest Baptist Study and Club. We look forward to seeing you again next week.
Thank you.